Welcome back. The last video was about crystal structure. In this video, we'll learn how to model some important nanomaterials, for example, carbon nanotubes and quantum dots. Now, among the allotropes of carbon, thermodynamically, the most stable form is graphite. It is a 2D network solid with layers that can potentially move relative to each other. As a result, graphite has lubricant properties, whereas diamond, which is also a network solid, but in this case, the network extends in all three dimensions. As a consequence, diamond is extremely tough, and we know that it is the hardest naturally occurring material. Fullerene is an unusual and basically man-made form of carbon. It is composed of ball-shaped molecules that have been the subject of much research. A lot of research has also been devoted to single layer graphite called graphene. The free valencies at the edges of the flake-like model are saturated with hydrogen. And when you roll this, you'll get carbon nanotubes. The carbon nanotube may be a single-walled carbon nanotube or a multi-walled carbon nanotube, or you can also model nanoribbons called Möbius strips. Theoretically, it has been demonstrated that they are stable enough and may be a synthetic target. So let's try to model these nanosystems using Avogadro. Let's first try to model a multi-walled carbon nanotube. For this, go to Build menu. There's an option called Nanotube Builder. Click on this. At the bottom, you'll find option to vary N and M chiral indices. The chiral indices specify the perimeter of carbon nanotube on the graphene net. So now let's change this value to 6 and 6. By default, the length is in angstrom. You can change that value. You can also change the unit to bore radii or nanometers or picometers. There's an option called cap with hydrogen and find double bond. By default, cap with hydrogen is in the check mode. So the remaining valency at the edges of carbon nanotube will be completed by hydrogens. And then click on the build. And the carbon nanotube will appear in the build panel. To get a proper view, go to View menu and click on the option called Center. Yes, we got a single walled carbon nanotube. Deselect this. You can do it by the Select menu, Select None. Perfect. Now, if I want to convert the single walled carbon nanotube to multi-walled carbon nanotube, let's insert another layer inside this particular one. So I again go to Build menu. Option again, Nanotube Builder. And now, the chiral indices lower this value to 4 and 4. Again, click on the Build button. Got that. But you need to adjust this. Let's rotate this. Sorry. Go to the Navigation tool and then try to rotate. Perfect. Now you see that they're overlapping. So you need to displace this, and that you can do it via manipulation tool. Either use the left hand side translation option. You can translate by x axis by some value. So you can change this to, for example, 1 angstrom. Along y-axis to 1 angstrom, let's see what happens. Yes, slightly got displaced, but displaced a bit larger one. So the best thing is, since already the inner one is in the selected mode, so you can select the, you can displace this manually, right? And then if you want, you can also use auto-optimization tool to optimize the particular model, but that's your option. You can do it by molecular mechanics, or you can do it, you can use this as a research structure and use ab initio based geometry optimizers. So this is how we can model multi-walled carbon nanotube. Now let's learn how to model a fluorine type model. For that, go to build menu. In the insert option, choose fragment. You'll find an option fluorine, the fluorine folder. Click on this, double click. You get different versions of fluorines. Let's click the C60 buckyball. Click on insert. Yes, close this. Right now in the selected mode, you can choose the select tool and then right click. So you got a buckyball in your display panel. You can play with this. For example, if I want to encapsulate any ion or an atom or a molecule within this, I can do that. For example, go to draw tool, and in the element drop down menu, let's choose sodium. So that's not there. So I'll click on other and then sodium, select sodium and click within this buckyball. So what do you got? You got, so let me uncheck this and then click on, something happened. We clicked on the wrong atom. So let me undo this, Control Z, and then Control Z. So it's already sodium. So again, I'll do that. So, okay, you got sodium. And now, to get a proper view, you can rotate this. Yes, you got sodium encapsulated inside the buckyball. You can make the sodium sodium ion, but that will do when we'll do some ab initio calculations. And another category of nanomaterial is quantum dot, which are currently in much demand. And as you can see from the NREL photovoltaic research cell efficiency chart, that within emerging photovoltaic category, one of the options is quantum dot cells, various types. The one with the diamond sign, that's there. That is, in the last 10 years, one of the steepest ascent in the photovoltaic efficiency corresponds to the quantum dot based solar cells. The efficiency has gone till now in the range of around 18% to 19%. And a typical commercial solar cell has efficiency in between 15% to 20%. The story of this emerging photovoltaic started in 1990 when Gretzel Group at EPFL lab in Switzerland came with the concept of dye-sensitized solar cells. The normal working of Gretzel cell is the dye, which acts as a sensitizer, after absorbing photons, the electrons from the occupied levels of dye gets excited to the unoccupied level. And then these excited electrons are injected into the conduction band of the semiconductor, which results into creation of hole on the dye and the charge on the semiconductor. This charge transfer is a prerequisite for any solar cell application. And the electron which is there in the semiconductor gets collected by the electrodes, and this dye gets regenerated by the help of this redox couple, I negative, I three negative, and the cycle continues. But as we can see from this chart, there was marginal increase in the efficiency in the last 20 years in case of dye sensitized cells. So researchers started looking for different options, and one of them was no doubt quantum dot. And in this area, we also model a system that is dye-sensitized quantum dot. The quantum dot was created by bifurcating a small portion of the bulk material in the spherical shape as much as possible. But when you do the bifurcation, when you do this cutting, it results into formation of dangling bonds on the surface. Dangling bond means normally the ions which are in the bulk, for example, in this case, has coordination number 4. The cadmium is surrounded by 4 sulfide ion in the tetrahedral fashion. Sulfide ion is surrounded by 4 cadmium ion in the tetrahedral fashion. But the ions which are present on the surface has coordination number less than 4. So we want to make it as higher as possible by the help of passivating agents. In experiments, the passivating agents are normally long chain fatty acids. But due to the computational timing restraint, we have to look for an analog of we need to mimic the long chain fatty acids, and which we did with the help of acetate ions. To our help, the quantum dot which we created was very stable, and surprisingly, it was found to be a fullerene analog. That's what we have written there. We prepared different sizes of quantum dots. And we also placed a dye on the surface of the quantum dot to make it a dye-sensitized quantum dot. Do remember, when you do such type of modeling, electrical neutrality must be maintained. The total positive charge must be balanced by the total negative charge. So let me show you the model which we actually created. So to do that, in the Avogadro, go to File menu, and using Open option, navigate to your desired folder and upload the file. Since I've already used so many times, so it's already there in the open recent option. There is a file name 16gum.log. Let's click on this. And yes, that's the model. So this is the quantum dot, which we have labeled them because we have checked the label option. So the atom type and the atom number is mentioned there. That's the cadmium ion and that's a sulfide ion. So you can see that the one which is there in the bulk has coordination number 4. But the one on the surface, if you leave this oxide, then it is coordination number 2. But by the help of these passivating agents, at least we tried to get the coordination number 3, which is good enough. And also we placed a dye on the surface via the carboxylate oxygen atom. And using this model, we were able to explain the electronic and optical properties, and along with that, the possible charge transfer. It could be an indirect charge transfer where the dye absorbs the photon, goes to the excited state, and then injects the electron to the conduction band of the semiconductor, that is in this case, quantum dot. Or the dye directly transfers the electron to the conduction band of the semiconductor. So this is called indirect charge transfer. That's called direct charge transfer. And we were able to explain that in these two papers. And very recently, this was published in 2015 and that's in 2018. So let me explain the basic steps you can follow to get such type of model. So go to File menu. In the Import section, click on Crystal. And then you have different folders for different categories of solids. Since right now I'm interested in cadmium sulfide, so look for the sulfide folder. Click on this. CDS is there. Two different varieties,
and with .cif file, that is crystallographic information file, let's open this CIF file, insert. Okay, so you got CDS. So clearly this is corner and face center. So each sulfide ion is surrounded by four cadmium ion in the tetrahedral fashion. And similarly, each cadmium ion will be surrounded by four sulfide ion in the tetrahedral fashion. Now let's try to build supercell. Go to build menu, the supercell builder, and then increase the number along the three directions. Click on generate cell, close, you got a supercell. And now to obtain cluster, remove this unit cell because you are not going to do the periodic calculation. So there's option in crystallography menu, remove unit cell, click on this. Now you have cluster of atoms. And try to obtain your desired structure, shape, whatsoever you want, by deleting the ions on the surface with least coordination number, that is to minimize the dangling bonds. So to get a proper view, the best thing, that's a one trick you can play, and that will be helpful while creating your desired quantum dot, is save this file in PDB format. So go to file menu, save as, and then among this choose PDB, this PDB option, and give a name to this system. Let's name this as QD1, and then save. Now close this and then again reopen this. You'll see some difference there. Let me close this. Go to file, open recent one, that's the first one, QD1 PDB, because that's the one which you just created. Click on this. Look at that. There's a difference now. Now they show you the bonds. And in this form, it becomes easier for us to decide the coordination number, the one with the minimum coordination number. So you can simply see that these are the atoms which are singly bonded. So remove these such type of ions from the surface. So go to draw tool, click on this, remove it, right click. So right click will delete. Now you have to spend some time to get a proper view. Again, we'll find few more there. Go to the first draw tool option and then right click. Try to minimize that. So you have to spend some time on this. So keep on doing that, rotating and deleting the unnecessary. Again, you'll find one here. So go to this, delete, and repeat this. So I think we are done with it. There's no atom, no ion on the surface with single coordination number. Either the coordination number is 3 or coordination number is 2. Now, count the number of cadmium ion and sulfide ion. The one thing which I mentioned earlier, that you have to maintain the electrical neutrality. So do it in that fashion that you have more cadmium ion as compared to sulfide ion, so that you can further use acetate ion to make few surface ions. You can increase the coordination number from 2 to 3 or from 3 to 4, so on. So how to do that? How to put acetate ion or a dye on the surface? So acetate, you can get it from. So in the build menu, there's option insert, fragment. Look for acids, carboxylic acids. And then look for acetic acid, it's there. So choose this, insert. Delete this. So you got an acetate ion. You can get as number of acetate you require. So let's now concentrate on one of them. So this is already in the selected mode. So you can simply displace this. You can displace this. you can rotate in your desired orientation form so that the carboxylate ion is closer to the cadmium ions. These are cadmium ions. So cadmium ion will be attached to the oxygen of the acetate ion. So slightly bring this and then go to draw tool, uncheck adjust hydrogen, and you can delete the hydrogen from the carboxylate group. And now uncheck this, deselect this, right click. So you see that you have brought the oxygen of the carboxylate in between the two cadmium. And you can similarly put more acetate in between two cadmium because this will be associated with this. You can also put a bond between this. So draw a tool and then put this, some type of bond there, like that. Right? So when you do the geometry optimization during ab initio calculation, they themselves know that this will be a dotted bond, not a complete covalent bond, Otherwise, this will acquire a positive charge. So simultaneously, once you assign the charge on the complete system by Millikan population analysis, they will further assign charge on the on each ions after optimization. So similarly, you can put more than one acetate ion on the surface. That's one simple procedure to do that. Now let's try to put a dye. Now I already have a file of dye, and that is this C343, coumarin 343, which we have modeled earlier. So that's there. So copy this, go to view menu, edit, and then copy, close this, and then simply paste on this. So paste. Okay, so that's in the selected mode. And now bring to this to the desired position. You can rotate the system accordingly, bring the carboxylate group closer to the cadmium ion. Right now you can select this. So you have to play with this. You have to bring this acetate ion closer to the cadmium ion. So play with this. So now you have brought the carboxylate group of this dye closer to the two cadmium ion. Now deselect this. So opt for select tool, right click, and then remove this hydrogen. So go to draw tool and then right click. And now make a bond between this oxygen and these two cadmium. So that you can do it, click and drag and click and drag. So I hope we have done this. So let's slightly rotate this. We made with these two cadmium. So better. Yeah, even this will work, and then slightly you can modify. So this is the procedure to obtain a passivated dye-sensitized quantum dot. Again, repeat, you have to count the number of cadmium ion and sulfide ion, and the difference in the charge should be balanced by some coion. So if there's more positive charge, then use acetate ion. There's more negative charge, then you can use positive ions like methylamine or H positive ion. And this is how we passivate them. So I think play with this, try to model the system which we have published that has cadmium 16, sulfur 13, and then four acetate ion. That was one model, or with three acetate and one dye.
An important development happened in 2009 in the field of emerging photovoltaic, when a Japanese group tried to replace the dye by an organic inorganic perovskite, and that was actually methylamine lead bromide as a photosensitizer. When they deposited these nanocrystalline on the TiO2, that is semiconductor TiO2 surface. But very soon, within 2-3 years, it was realized that they not only act as a sensitizer, but on its own, they are capable of separating the electron and hole. And soon it became the focus of research. And you can see that ever since it was realized that they can separate electron and hole, and that was around 2013, that in the last 8 years, there's a sharp shoot in the efficiency of the perovskite-based solar cells. And at the research level, it has reached almost 25%. The importance can easily go is that routinely it appears on the front page of important journals. But the structure of perovskite was known ever since 1840s, where a typical calcium titanate, which has a perovskite structure, one of the ion is at the body center, the other cation, means one of the cation is at the body center, the other cation is at the corner, and the anion occupy the center of edges. So similarly, in the case of ABX3 type, the halides, halogens are present at the S center. One of the cation, if that is at the body center, the other cation, that is other cation, will be at the corner, and vice versa. But remember, this monocation ion should be of bigger size to form a stable perovskite structure. So in the hybrid, either it is methylamine or formamidium ion. But due to this organic nature, there is some stability issue. And also, lead ion has some environmental issue. So many researchers are working on, is there any possibility of having high efficiency perovskite solar cell material using all inorganic material? In this line, we also did some modeling, and very recently we published a paper in JPC where we modeled a green lead-free perovskite quantum dot. And the purpose was for photovoltaic application and using electronic structure calculation and TDDFT calculation, we are able to study the electronic and optical properties and explain the charge transfer to why they are not as good as the lead-based quantum dot. So let's try to model this system. And we'll also learn how to obtain the data of a typical perovskite from any open database.
So now let's learn how to download a .cif file, a desired .cif file from an open database. So in Google, type crystallography open database, click on this. You'll be directed to this particular page. Then click on the option search. You'll get this particular table to fill. The different ways to get your desired .cif file. The simplest one is in the text, you simply type, for example, if I want to obtain cesium, tin, iodide, enter. Or you can click on this send. And very soon you'll find a list of .cif file deposited by various research groups in this database. That's there. And the information about the paper in which they had published the complete information. So in this case, we find four of them. So let's click on the first one. That is cesium-10-I3. All of them are cesium-10-I3, but different space groups. So click on the first one. And very soon, your file will get downloaded. So save this in your desired folder. I've already saved that. Now let's open this in Avogadro. So from the file menu, navigate to that particular folder. So open. Then I've kept that in a folder named Our Models. Now, look at that. That file we are not able to see in this. That reason is, at present it is, the extension name is .cml, but that file had extension name .cif. So best way is, you can click at all files. Yes, you got that one with the crystallography information file. So choose this and then open. Yes. So this shows that you can obtain your desired crystal structure from any open database. I showed you one of them, but there are other database also, open database. So you can get it from your desired library, and you can search for that. And now you want to create a quantum dot. So go to build and then supercell builder, increase the number along the three directions, generate cell, close it, and repeat again what we did in the earlier time, the earlier case, CDS, remove unit cell, and now play with this. So you can save this, save as, or you can simply do it in this way. Let this name this as QD2, and then save, close this, again open recent one, QD2 PDB. So you got some bonds here, not all of them, not with the bigger one, but you got some idea. And now with the help of navigation tool, it's a slab type thing. So it's basically a typical cuboid form, but you can play with this. You can delete the unnecessary ions. So you have to devote some time for obtaining your desired structure. And electric, do remember, you have to maintain the electrical neutrality. Fine. So in this lab session, we discussed about some important nanomaterials and how to obtain, how to model those nanomaterials.